That's tomorrow night. It's on ESPN and on the ESPN app. And Farnham, the Pacers continue to be a team no one talks about, no one thinks about, and they just keep winning games.
Yeah, I remember during this free agent special time here, I said if Victor Oladipo can come back healthy, this team all of a sudden becomes a team that competes in the East. I think there's a chance that they do that here after the All-Star break.
A team to watch. Another hour coming your way here live from the Seaport District at Pier 17. We're brought to you by Chase, and this is what is coming your way. It is time to get up with Tua. The news is good, and so the race is on. We'll tell you exactly what it will now take to get this potential superstar in the draft. Plus, speaking of superstars, wait until you hear what one legend has to say about this one and what that might mean for him in the next month. Lots of football future and off an easy night at the office. Do the Lakers and LeBron face a decision he absolutely doesn't want to make? Answers to those and other questions on this hour of Get Up. After we answer these with our insider Jeff Darlington, let's run the hurry up. What is the latest on Dak Prescott in Dallas?
It's not going great, Greeny. And look, we talk about leverage all the time. Both sides now trying to look for the leverage that can maybe get this deal done. But right now, Dak Prescott looking for Russell Wilson money and not a penny less. If he doesn't get there by the start of free agency, I could honestly see, I know people call me crazy, Dak Prescott trying to enter free agency.
We talked about this earlier. Marcus Spears losing his mind on Twitter. We'll get to it. Meanwhile, what can you tell us about Tom Brady?
Well, look, I know a lot of people are wondering, first of all, Greeny yourself, you wondered yesterday if this decision has been made. I don't believe that. In fact, I know that not to be true. But we can sit here and wonder what it's going to look like as he does go into this free agency process. Tell you this, it's not going to be like it was with Peyton Manning when he's, you know, helicopters chase him around,
yeah,
going city to city. It will be clear, it will be concise, and it will happen soon.
And then how about this guy, Tua Tagovailoa?
Well, look, recent tests saying that his hip is feeling good, but it's going to be up to what teams decide. Once teams start to really get in there and decide if he's healthy or not, we'll find out exactly where he is slotted to go. But what I keep hearing is that Detroit pick at third overall will be up for sale. Detroit will try to get something heavy for that, and they'll target a team that is looking to draft Tua at the third spot.
No one is closer to the situation than Laura is. What can you fill us in on as far as the medical stuff?
Yeah, well, it's very positive reports coming out of everything that's gone on with Tua, and that's been the case this whole time since he had the surgery on that hip, and it's just been that he's been ahead of schedule. Everything that's happened, every benchmark, he's been ahead of that, and the reports have been fantastic. In fact, that's a word that a doctor has used to me that's very close to the thing, and I think when these NFL doctors and these teams are trying to find out more, Greeny, the important thing to note is they're looking at the entire history of how this went down, and the fact that they were able to perform this surgery so quickly, they were able to put the hip back into place almost immediately after the injury occurred, that gives you assurance that not only that the hip has been already healed, which is a good thing, but also that it wouldn't happen again. That's going to be one of the main questions that will be asked through all this.
We have Keyshawn Johnson back with us again today. He was with us yesterday, and he's with us from up there in Bristol. Good morning, Key. I want to ask you this. As you have watched and evaluated the quarterbacks in this draft, before the season began, I think everyone thought Tua was the best. In your mind, if he's healthy, is he the best quarterback in the draft this year?
You know, I had an opportunity to see him play since he's been at Alabama. But, you know, to me, I look at his history of injuries. That concerns me. If I'm a general manager or president of a team, I want my doctors to tell me with uncertain that this man can recover and he'll be on the field for us, not necessarily this year, but in a couple years. But in terms of the top quarterback in this draft for me is Justin Herbert. I just like Herbert. I like his size. He showed me some running ability to a degree against Wisconsin in a Rose Bowl. And the thing, when you go back to Tua and you look at what makes him great, it's not the arm strength. It's his ability to move around, get outside the pocket, buy time for the receivers to get open. Will he be able to do that at the next level?
Interesting there. And that's I'm not going to say an unpopular opinion, but it's sort of opposed to what we're hearing from most people. Bobby, I keep referring to Herbert as the guy that the NFL evaluators are going to talk themselves into. They're going to love him because he is exactly what quarterbacks have historically looked like in the NFL. But the league is changing.
He's the prototype. He's the guy that everybody wants, like you said. However, you know, you look at Tua, he can move around a little more. He can deliver those off-schedule plays. Even Joe Burrow, like an underrated athlete. You watch him pull the ball down, move, his pocket presence. Like, you're watching Herbert. I like him. He does some things well, but there's some inconsistencies there that I have a hard time getting over if you're going to take him in the top five.
Keyshawn mentioned the Rose Bowl. I think he showed a lot to people there. The questions that I hear about Herbert are, does he have that moxie about him? Does he have the ability to lead, you know, the way that they would want to see? And you see that from both Burrow and Tua. That's a big part of this. When you look at the guy, he's got everything, as you mentioned. But he also showed a lot at the Senior Bowl. And in a lot of the conversations out of that, he had a great Senior Bowl performance, Jeff. I think probably elevated him, at least in some people's eyes. I could see him climbing up there, and we're not talking about him enough.
Well, by the way, if Tua were to wind up getting drafted at three by, say, a team like the Chargers that's currently at six, then maybe a team at five like the Dolphins ends up looking at Herbert. So there are teams in that top six, more than three, that are three, I should say, that are looking for a quarterback.
Just one interesting thing on the Dolphins and the history lesson that, you know, people may have been forgetting. If you go back to 2006, you know, Drew Brees and Dante Culpepper were the two quarterbacks that were widely assumed, you know, to be two free agent pieces. Drew's coming off of the injured shoulder. He doesn't get cleared by the Miami medical staff. They end up going with Dante Culpepper. Drew ends up going to the New Orleans Saints. And so you have to ask yourself, what's the Miami Dolphins' risk aversion with bringing in quarterbacks or bringing in any player who has an injury history, and could they get him cleared? And that's not to say that he couldn't go on to do great things elsewhere as well.
Can I ask you one other question, just because this came up earlier? I agree with you. Detroit at three is the spot that I would assume everyone is eyeing if they want to trade up and get the quarterback, which suggests to me that all of a sudden the second pick becomes a fascinating one, because that isn't a quarterback spot. Now it's Chase Young, and I know everyone loves him. But does someone look at two and say, you know what, I got to go all the way up to there to be sure I get the player I want?
I have a tough time believing that, because I think that Ron Rivera will adore Chase Young.
Got it.
And that, you know, if it was maybe an offensive-minded guy, you wanted to get a haul of picks, maybe. I just think Ron Rivera, that could be a perfect generational talent for him.
Let's talk about Tom Brady.
Okay.
It's time to do that again. Okay, he's doing something that he hasn't done before, exploring the possibility of leaving the New England Patriots. Recently, TMZ asked Hall of Fame quarterback Brett Favre about how good Brady actually is entering his 21st season. Here's what Favre said. He said, quote, "I hear a lot of so-called experts say his age is catching up with them. I don't see that. I see a quarterback still doing what he does, but the cast around him was not up to par. I think his game is as good as it's ever been." So while Favre may not see a regression in Tom Brady's game, last season's numbers paint a slightly different picture. His 53.7 total QBR was his worst in a season since the metric began in 2006. And at 42 years of age, his status as a top-tier signal caller is certainly up in the air. So Keyshawn's still with us here. And look, you could blame it on the lack of weapons, but what do you think about Brady, Key? Is he still at the same level?
I kind of agree with Brett Favre right there. When you look at Tom Brady's body of work, let's not look at the statistics. It wasn't Brady's fault that the guy dropped the ball and it was a pick six at the end of the playoffs. So when you start to break him down, there's some throws that he missed. All quarterback missed throws. But he didn't have the weapons around him that he had in the past. I know when you look at some balls, they're throwaways because the offensive line is not protecting him. He doesn't want to take the hits. But look, at the end of the day, he's dropping dimes on wide receivers. They've got to catch the ball. They've got to get open. They've got to do those sort of things. When he signs back with them and they retool this offensive line and retool the receiving core, everybody will be going, damn.
Keyshawn, you are 47 years old, and I'm not convinced you wouldn't have been the best weapon that they could have had last year. I'm surprised they didn't call you that. Literally, it was on that kind of level. So I just want to make that point to illustrate that I'm completely on your side. Do I believe that Brady is the same quarterback he was 20 years ago? No one is the same player they were 20 years ago, but he is still, I believe, an upper echelon quarterback.
Julian Edelman was his best target and just had surgery on his shoulder to get a bone that was stuck out of there for most of the season back into place. What does that tell you about the targets that Tom Brady had this season?
And to dovetail off like what Keyshawn said, like the numbers don't tell you everything in isolation, because it's not like baseball where it's a one-on-one sport. And so you have to watch some of the throws. And the most difficult throws for quarterbacks to make on the football field are those throws outside the numbers plus 10 yards. And you watch him make some of those, he can still drive the football with accuracy. He still does a good job with that. Some point in time, a guy's got to step up and make a play for the guy. I mean, he's doing everything he can.
You know why I think that Brady is so frustrated? Because the reality is, if you look at it, and why some of the inside people at the Patriots that people like you talk to are trying to paint a narrative where Brady has lost a little something here, it's because The reality of it is they've drafted terribly, absolutely terribly in the last few years. They've made one mistake after another. They've let one good player after another walk away. They've taken risks in the wrong places. And Brady has covered up a lot of other deficiencies.
I feel like we're being a very pro-Brady table here, and I'm going to continue that, by saying that I remember when Rex was here one time talking about how Bill Belichick should be coach of the year for being able to get as much out of these players. He picked the players.
Right.
He's the one who's responsible for bringing those players into that building. So for Tom Brady to have to make the most out of that is one thing. If we look at the first 3 weeks of the season, less than what, 4 or 5 months ago? Tom Brady looked like he was an elite quarterback then.
And that's a little bit of the irony, as Bill Belichick, the GM, has let down Bill Belichick, the head coach, at certain points in time. And I just want you to remind you back to the middle of the season. When they signed Mohamed Sanu, we acted like that was going to be the be-all, end-all. He is the piece that they needed. He was the third receiver. The third receiver for the Atlanta Falcons. It's not like this guy was an ace that they were bringing in. They weren't bringing in A.J. Green. He was one of the backups, and so we expected him to make that big difference, and it never materialized.
Let me very quickly throw a key, because we talked about it earlier this morning, and everyone is freaking out. Marcus is yelling at us on Twitter. Keyshawn, the notion of Brady to Dallas, which, again, no one is suggesting. Go ahead. I see your face. Go.
Like, come on. Seriously, like that, why would that conversation, that's wasting airspace, Greeny. You need these minutes back in your life. Why would you want to talk about Brady to Dallas? It'll never happen. He's going to one team. It's one team. He's going back to New England. Oh. I know we're fascinated with this. I know we want to talk about it, and we want to take it all the way up to March 18th. We want to get there at 12 a.m. We want to do all those sort of things. But Greeny, he's going back to New England.
That will take, if this was marriage counseling and Bill Belichick and Tom Brady are entering that room, they're going to have to get on a better page than they're on right now.
Here's what I would say. Being around Bill and having been in the room with Bill and kind of understanding him, he's not giving you any love. There will be no love. There's no kissy-kissy. He's not going to tell you what you want to hear until the end. When you retire, he'll finally say something positive. He'll finally pat you on the back. That's just who he is. And what happens is we spend a lot of our time trying to dissect the relationship. The relationship. He found him in the sixth round. He's played for him for 20 years. Think about it. The only quarterback that I can think of, and you can correct me, Greeny, because you're a historian at this stuff, is Joe Montana, who was asked to leave the Kansas City Chiefs, but he went with Paul Hackett, his quarterback coach, as his offensive coordinator. Other than that, Peyton Manning had an injury. You don't leave unless they ask you to leave in New England.
Correct. The legend
is not asking him to leave.
The point I think you're making, and I think it is correct, is that we have talked a lot about all these legends who leave one team and wind up someplace else. It is almost never because they decide they want to be somewhere else. There are extenuating circumstances, usually in the fact that Aaron Rodgers is waiting behind Brett Favre. Andrew Luck is sitting there to be drafted, and the Colts want to move on from Peyton. Those are usually the way that stuff goes.
And I get all that, but you don't have to tell me that. You have to tell Tom Brady that, because he's the one who's making this decision. And after 20 years of getting just totally, I don't know, I can't use the word on TV, by Bill Belichick.
Yes.
Oh. He now is looking at it to say, maybe you want to go have some fun for a couple years.
All right.
You don't tell
you guys
me.
Are unbelievable, man.
We're going to get back to Keyshawn on this.
The guy just won a Super Bowl 14, 15 months ago. Stop.
Call Tom Key.
It was 12 months ago, actually.
Yeah, it really was.
They 12,
were the defending
yeah,
champs until 2 weeks ago. All right, go ahead. What's the next business?
Let's talk about a quarterback who is also a legend already and said he's not going to go anywhere except the Saints unless he retires, and he could become an unrestricted free agent. So it begs the question, who will be the starting quarterback for the Saints? Will it be Drew Brees? Will it be Teddy Bridgewater? Would it be Taysom Hill? All three are free agents. And so our NFL experts offered their predictions. And this is interesting. If you look down the line at all of these experts, Jeremy Fowler, Dan Graziano, all these guys say that it would either be Drew Brees or Taysom Hill. Nobody says Teddy Bridgewater, which I think a lot of people, when you look at all the free agent quarterbacks that are going to be part of this, you know, Teddy Bridgewater seems like a guy that could go somewhere else. Key, when you see how everybody's kind of predicting this between Drew Brees going back to the Saints instead of retiring, or Taysom Hill being the guy there, and then where does Teddy Bridgewater fall in all of this? What are your thoughts?
It's going to be Drew Brees. Drew Brees is running it back, and so is Sean Payton. This is one of those classic situations. Teddy Bridgewater has an opportunity to make money. He hasn't, you know, if he didn't get hurt in Minnesota, he'd be obviously their quarterback in doing terrific things. If Taysom Hill was such the guy that we all thought, how come he wasn't number two on the depth chart in starting those five games that Teddy Bridgewater started for them? I find it hard, and I understand we love Taysom Hill. It's one thing to throw 13 passes in your career. It's another thing to engineer 60 plays in a game, in an NFL game, and not things that are designed for you to have success. So I don't necessarily see Sean Payton putting this team, that's a Super Bowl-ready team, in Taysom Hill's hands. I just don't see it.
I tend to agree, yeah. And I maybe it's just because I'm sort of a skeptic on this stuff, but what is Taysom Hill? He looks like someone said it here the other day. He's a great change of pace, but if he's the pace, then you have a problem.
I think what Sean Payton's ultimate dream is and his goal is to begin to change that pace over the course of this year where they begin to integrate him more into the offense. Taysom Hill views himself as a potential franchise quarterback, so he isn't necessarily just the gimmick guy who's running around, who's catching passes, who's running out of the backfield, but ultimately they begin to build some packages and build some more things for him to play quarterback so that they can make this smooth transition, which is probably maybe not going to happen this year, but maybe next season.
Well, Hill can be a free agent. I guess the question is someone else out there thinking of signing him and making him their starting quarterback?
I think the Saints are fearful of that, and from the standpoint you talk about him being a free agent, he'd be a restricted free agent. The Saints, I would anticipate, put a first-round tender on him, which means that if a team wants to come after him, they have to give a first-round pick to the Saints, and the Saints now have the chance to match.
And to be clear, it means they pay him more money, right? I mean, that's how that stuff works, in case you're wondering. But what does that mean? They don't just willy-nilly give these things out. It means they have to pay him more money.
No, teams rarely do because you do have to pay him more money. To your point before, I see them, if Brees were to retire, I see Taysom Hill returning with the first-round tender, but I still see Teddy Bridgewater as the week one starter, personally. Mm-hmm.
Keyshawn, great to see you. As always, thank you for jumping in with us here, and we will see you down here tomorrow so you can yell at us.
Yay.
In person.
I'm not yelling. I just don't understand some of the things that certain people say. That's all.
The story of my career. Done, Keyshawn. Thank you so much. We'll see you tomorrow. Meanwhile, to the NBA and a fellow by the name of LeBron James and the Lakers hosting the Suns last night. We're going to pick up the action in the second quarter because LeBron is throwing just dimes. Maybe he, Sean Farnham, should be the quarterback for the Chargers next year.
Is he available via free agency for the NFL? If he is, I would sign him because he has been delivering it on spot, on target, on time all season long.
He had 6 assists in the first half, and then he's not the only one throwing nice passes, Danny Green.
Any defense by the Suns? Defense optional, evidently.
The Lakers had a 9-point halftime lead. We go to the third quarter, and here's more LeBron. Here's the flick pass.
It's really getting to a point where it's just kind of silly. You get an amazement with his ability to pass, not just his ability to score.
Well, a bad moment here. Pay no attention to where the basketball goes. Just watch LeBron on this play here as you see the elbow that sort of awkward hits there. He's holding it. He's hurt. He's sort of shaking it out. Here's the good news. He stayed in the game. Obviously, it wasn't that bad. And clearly, it didn't interfere with his touch because very immediately afterwards, he throws that.
That's a touch pass.
Yes. Yeah.
No, it just... The Lakers' success this season has been largely predicated upon LeBron James' ability to facilitate his offense and make those around him better.
And knock down threes when they need him, too. He puts that
three
one in there.
Six on the game.
He had 17 points, 9 assists, 8 rebounds on the night. Lakers pulling away easily. And then it was a night that would belong to a fellow by the name of Rajon Rondo.
Who?
Rondo.
What say you?
I say he had 23 points, a season high for him. And it was the Lakers an easy win, 125-100. LeBron and the Lakers, the top seed in the West right now, second best record in the sport. They've been playing in the shadow of Giannis to some degree all year. The two have both accounted for over 20% of their team's total points this year, and most agree the two are the leading candidates for the MVP award. I don't know that LeBron ever plays in anybody's shadow, but Giannis obviously has been spectacular. If you had to vote for MVP right now, who'd you give it to?
It's LeBron James. And I tell you, there's multiple reasons why it stands out to me that LeBron is over Giannis. And I get the fact that the Bucks are having this great season and Giannis has been so strong. But some of this has to do with reinventing yourself and understanding how you can control a game. He's always been an elite-level passer. But let's put this into some context. He's 35 years of age. He's never led the NBA in assists. The last time a 35-year-old led the league in assists, you want to know the name? Steve Nash. Mm. Slightly different physical stature between the two. Sure. He's done a tremendous job really orchestrating this offense, getting everybody involved. The competition strength also has to be pointed out. The Western Conference is superior to the Eastern Conference. And in fact, you look at the head-to-head matchups, the Western Conference is plus 28 games over the East. So Giannis is putting up a lot of big numbers, but he's putting it up against inferior competition, comparatively speaking to that in which LeBron James is having to go against on a night-in, night-out basis. Who's he being guarded by? Guys like Kawhi Leonard on a consistent basis. I think you've got to put some value in stock in that, and then greatest value overall. The real plus-minus is the best way to value your impact to the team's success. LeBron James is number one in the NBA and is 35% better. 35% better in that analytical stat over Giannis, who is number two in the NBA. So when you look at the overall value and what you mean to your team, what you mean to your organization, that's why you put the onus on LeBron James. That's why he's my MVP.
I like it. It's sometimes sort of an emotional vote as well. Like people will kind of go, he's 35 years old. Giannis has a lot more years to do this. I'm with you. I think if everything stays as it is, I think that he will wind up winning it. Okay, we'll take a short break. As we continue, the Chargers make it official. Phillip Rivers won't be back. Will he be an NFL starter week one next year? We'll answer that question. And after shushing the crowd in Philly, Joel Embiid gets cryptic on Instagram about his future. How's the process looking these days? We're talking about it coming up. Get up, ESPN.